go. Welcome everyone to Topics in the Aesthetics of Music and Sound. Today we are continuing with our series Mostly Metal, and Søren Frimodt Møller will talk to us about progressive metal, actually posing the question, what is progressive about progressive metal? But before we get going, in order to make this all seem as if we are sitting around a table in one room having a seminar, rather than being spread about among today three different countries, we take a short round of introductions so we all know who is here, and a very short motivation as to what the interest of each participant is in this seminar series. So I'll start briefly. It's always a pleasure to host Topics in the Aesthetics of Music and Sound. I'm Cynthia Grund. I'm an associate professor of philosophy here at the University of Southern Denmark, and have been interested in philosophy of music for a long time. I have to admit, I'm a newbie to metal, but I'm loving it. So let's continue. Johnny, who is holding the camera, maybe wants to do a selfie for YouTube.
Yeah. Oh, I'd love to. Hi, I'm Johnny. I'm MA in Comparative Literature here from SDU. I'm not a newbie in metal. I've listened to metal for a lot of years, and I'm looking very much forward to what Søren has to tell us today.
What do you want to reveal? Yes, okay. Lovely. Thank you, Johnny.
Hi, I'm Lisa. I'm Søren's sister. And I've been listening to progressive metal for many, many years. And I'm mostly here to make sure that what Søren says makes sense.
Oh, we have quality control. Okay, very good, thank you.
My name is Elena. I studied a master's in American studies here at the University of SDU. And I'm not a huge metal fan or a fan at all, but I am developing an interest into how masculinity is constructed in the performance of metal music.
Ah,
yeah.
So maybe we'll rope you in with some sort of a research topic anyway.
Yeah.
Very good. Mons.
I'm Mons Davidson, part of the small research group where we are working with metal. I have no idea whatsoever what progressive metal is, in contrast to other kinds of metals that I'm looking forward to.
Okay, always great to have you here, Mons. Let's whip the camera around this way, yes?
Hi, I'm Evelyn. I'm a first year student at the MA Middle East Studies here at SDU, and I'm conducting a research in rhythmology and symbolism in metal lyrics.
Okay, always good to have you here, Evelyn. And Jarl, our faithful member, yes.
I'm interested in ontology, so everybody needs one.
That's right. Jarl Monson, our resident ontologist, never had a seminar without one. Yes, Andreas.
Hi, my name is Andreas. I'm a PhD fellow here at Media Science at the SDU. I am also a fan of progressive metal. I think it might show that what I listen to is in progressive metal. We'll see. Among other things, I have an interest in how philosophers try to make categories. So this might also be interesting in this point.
Mm. And I know metal people spend a lot of time worrying about how to establish categories. So, Vitus.
Yes, hello guys. My name is Vitus and I'm an assistant professor here at the University of Southern Denmark at Media Studies. And I'm also part of our small research group on metal and metal studies. And I'm very interested in this topic. I don't know a lot about progressive metal, and I am a little bit skeptical about progressive metal, so I'm really interested in hearing what Sam has to say.
Ah, this sounds like it's going to be a good day today.
Yes.
Okay, can we please continue out in Skype land, and it's nice to welcome everyone who is out in the ether, as it were, and especially Lars Norberg, who's with us for the first time today from Norway. You want to tell us a little bit about yourself, Lars?
Yes, I'm a PhD fellow in musicology at the University of Agder in Norway. And my research interest is not progressive metal, but notions of progress in heavy metal. So in short, I see it as manifested in heavy metal discourse and music as a sensibility. So this sensibility, I think, underpins progressive metal, but also notions of progressive metal, but it cannot be reduced to this. That's my take on it.
Okay, I think we're going to have a very good discussion today. And then our two participants from Finland who have been with us several times before, always good to see you. Daniel, a word about yourself.
I did my master's degree at SDU and I specialized in philosophy of music, and the thesis was about metal and authenticity. And currently I am a PhD student at Aalborg Academy University in Turku in Finland, where I'm researching into music performance aesthetics, mainly focused on the Finnish heavy metal scene.
Okay, great to have you here, Daniel. And last, but by no means least, Mika Silvanen.
Hello, everyone. I'm a teacher and researcher in the University of Tampere in department or school of information sciences. Though I have a music background, I am an ethnomusicologist and music educator from my degrees. As you may know, in Finland, it's a kind of statement that you have to actually place yourself what kind of metal you are actually listening to, because it's a, even though I listen very many types of music, my heart belongs to metal. But then again, I think that as a consumer, my taste has been recently fading away from progressive style, and because I know that Søren is very convincing guy, I like to know how he try to get my taste to the progressive style again.
Okay, Søren, you've got your work cut out for you. So Søren, would you like to now introduce yourself and a little bit more about your topic, and then we'll just get going here.
Sure. Well, yeah, my name is Søren from Møller, and I'm an assistant professor at Aalborg University in Esbjerg. We have a little campus over there, and I teach in the education called Mediology, which is kind of a media technology education. I have my PhD here from SDU in Odense, where I worked with Cynthia as a supervisor, and where I did my PhD dissertation within music philosophy, but more specifically on coordination problems in music ensembles and how to solve them, how musicians solve coordination problems. But the reason why I'm discussing this today, progressive metal, and by the way, for those wondering, this is the Norwegian progressive power metal band Pagan's Mind at a concert that I attended back in 2008. But the reason why I've chosen this subject for the seminar is that this is a topic that's personally very important to me, because progressive rock and metal was actually what got me into not only the prog genre spectrum as such, but also into metal in itself. Actually, it kind of coincided, and actually that's a topic that I'll be returning to a little bit later in my talk, because as some researchers pointed out, there's actually kind of a common history of development of the metal genre as such and progressive metal. The two have kind of been intertwined all the way through, although the term progressive metal is of a little newer date, but more on that a little bit later.
So May I ask one question before you continue, Søren, and this is just of the Skype audience. Can everyone see Søren and the screen well enough? Okay, is it clear? Good. Okay, thank you. Sorry.
Okay, I'll try not to blog too much. Alright, so one thing is that I have a personal history with progressive metal and progressive rock. Kind of the two genres are kind of, there's a kind of fluid boundaries between them, really. And it has been a favorite genre of mine, or if not a favorite genre of mine, then at least a kind of companion genre for me, because I mean, I've listened to a lot of other music. But it's been something that if I look at my record collection, I can see a kind of very large quantity of prog-related material in it. I also had an internet station, radio station, devoted to progressive rock and metal that I ran for 6 years, from 2007 to 2013, until I got tired of them not updating the upload software for my Mac platform. So I resigned out of frustration, really. And then finally, I've been giving a lot of thought to the way in which we could, or the problems with actually trying to define what progressive metal is, because the term seems to have some inbuilt contradictions. I mean, how do you have a genre which is progressive? Because you kind of have it seems like you build in innovation as a genre trait, but how can that be a genre trait? Because it seems to be something that should always be in development. But I think there are some interesting parallels between the way that people talk about progressive metal and the way that the genre is constructed, and some basic discussions of what philosophy is and how philosophy attitudes within philosophy develop. So that is kind of a secondary theme of today's talk, because I realized when I was starting to write this talk that there would probably be quite a lot in the audience who did not know what progressive metal was in advance. So the talk ended up being very much about characterizing progressive metal and about the problems with defining the genre. So I will be drawing some parallels to philosophy along the way, but they will not be kind of a central part of the talk. So, this is a short overview of the different things I'll be going through. I'll start with discussing some of the problems with defining progressive metal as a genre. Then I'll go into discussing a point of view that some people have put forward, namely that progressive metal is less a genre than more like an attitude towards music. Then I have a self-explanatory chapter of my talk called Canonization, or If Dream Theater Does It, It's Okay, which hints at something with respect to how Dream Theater has been extremely central in defining what counts as progressive metal and what does not. And that kind of leads me into discussion of family resemblances in relation to genre. This is something that I have been arguing in relation to metal in itself, that the way that the genre is constructed is very much defined by the seminal artists within the genre that people can kind of trace their genre or their style back to. So it's not like that is constitutive of the genre as such, but there seems to be a general genre traits or something that you can trace back to the first bands in any genre, basically. But that especially goes for progressive metal, in my opinion. Then we enter kind of the philosophical side here, where I discuss something about how some of the resemblances between the way that people talk about progressive metal today and the way philosophy develops. So I won't say too much about that right now in the meta-prog section here. But then I'll conclude with some kind of open questions, because as some of the metal aficionados may know, there's now beginning to become a lot of blending of genres, or that's been the case for many years now, actually. But there are a lot of metal genres that begin to take in elements from progressive metal and fuse them with a basic genre like black metal or true death metal or stuff like that. And so the question is what happens? I mean, what or rather when does it happen that a band that uses elements from the progressive metal genre becomes a full-fledged progressive metal band? How much do they have to bring in to the music before we stop calling them a progressive death metal band and just call them a progressive metal band, like Opeth, the case in point, for those of you who know them. But there will, of course, be a lot of examples, and the first one I'd like to play is from one of the seminal albums in the progressive metal genre, in my opinion. I'll argue a little bit more about for that in a moment, but I think that it's important also for the people who don't know what I'm talking about here at all, where they get some tastes of what progressive metal is. When I prepared for this talk, I started doing a short list of examples, like things that I thought would be good to have in the talk. And I thought I was being quite economical, but when I was done, I had a list that ran 2 hours. So I had to shorten it down a little. But I think there are some pieces that I will be playing parts of today, but I also think it's very important with a genre like progressive metal, for reasons I'll return to in a moment, that you actually get to hear some full pieces. Because something that characterizes progressive metal is that it has very long songs, typically, not always, but often very long songs. Some of the longest are up to like 40 minutes, 50 minutes. And there's a lot of different things happening within one particular single song. So to get a kind of idea of what kind of genre you have to deal with here, you basically need to hear at least a few examples of full songs. So the first one here I'd like to play is from Images and Words, the second album of Dream Theater from 1992. It's a song called Take the Time. And for those of you who have, those of you joining via Skype are welcome to find the song in your YouTube playlist is the first one, and hear it instead of hearing it via Skype in the meantime. So, here we go.
Yeah.
that was my first example for today. Now, now that you've heard what is kind of one of the archetypical progressive metal band Dream Theater, we can kind of get into discussing ways to describe this genre, because I mean, progressive metal is a lot of things, and it's very difficult to just describe them in terms of one particular artist. They are, as we will hear examples of in this talk, this is really a very, very diverse genre. But still, there are some reoccurring traits that one could point to. So the question of my talk today is, why is progressive metal called progressive metal? And there has been different attempts of explaining that. But I mean, basically, if we look at kind of the history of the term, I think. At least in mainstream use, you don't really hear the term before actually around Dream Theater, around the first Dream Theater albums. Before that, I mean, there was actually some bands that then went on to be called progressive metal bands, but the terms that were thrown around were more like thinking man's metal or sometimes even techno metal, and the tech metal term kind of was developed out of this, and it was something slightly different today. But the term progressive metal was not really something that people thought that much in terms of before, in the beginning of the 90s, when Dream Theater had their first period of greatness. You could actually compare it a little bit to the application of the term grunge, in the same way that Nirvana was actually not the first grunge band. You had bands like Soundgarden and Mudhoney and others who existed already in the 1980s, but they were the first ones to be called grunge. So after they were kind of christened grunge, then people went on to also call some of the other Seattle bands that preceded them and were similar grunge as well. So similarly, there's kind of a backwards causation or backwards rationalization when people talk about when did progressive metal start, because the term wasn't really thrown around until the early 90s, but then people have kind of traced the history of the genre back to, actually all the way back to Black Sabbath, but more about that later. Yeah, so similarly, the Dream Theater was definitely not the first progressive metal band, but it was one of the first to be called progressive metal. Now, the different definition attempts to define what progressive metal is, there has been a lot of different ones. Also, when you look to internet forums for characterizations of genres, there are some things that occur once in a while. The most simple one is, of course, to say, well, progressive metal is metal, which is progressive. So it's something that's innovative and actually has to progress. This is something that a lot of artists also hold. I mean, I recall reading an interview with Stephen Wilson of the band Porcupine Tree, who actually said that, well, in his opinion, you know, you have to do something new, because otherwise you wouldn't really be progressive if you just stayed within the same genre. But that exactly points to the problem with this definition attempt, namely that what about the bands that are only progressive in this sense in part of their career? So in the early Dream Theater is actually a very good case in point, because in the first three or four albums they made, they did actually progress from one album to the other. The four first Dream Theater albums are very, very different. They really pushed new boundaries at each time they released an album. But then after that, they kind of just settled into a template where it's basically been very much the same since around 2000 and up until now. In terms of the structure of the music, they've brought in, for different albums, they've brought in different kinds of inspirations from 80s thrash and Tool and Muse and Russian and a lot of other things, where they have kind of brought in as a kind of clear quotes from other artists, but the kind of basic structure of the music has been very much the same for a long time. But they're still considered a progressive metal band. It doesn't kind of, the tech doesn't magically disappear when you stop it being innovative. So there's a problem with that definition, at least if we use look at the way the term is actually used. Then there's the second definition attempt, and that is to say that, well, progressive metal is metal which is inspired by the progressive rock of the 1970s. And that is actually true of quite a lot of bands, at least. Cornerstone references for progressive metal are 70s bands such as Yes, Rush, the Canadian band Rush, King Crimson, Genesis, not the Phil Collins era, but the Peter Gabriel era, the early stuff with very long songs and so on, the Landmines down on Broadway and stuff like that. Pink Floyd, of course. And then for other artists, some other slightly less common but frequently occurring inspirations are Jethro Tull, Gentle Giant, Frank Zappa, and a lot of other bands. So there's definitely a lot of the same way that these bands were being very eclectic and weaving together different kinds of styles in their music, and also sometimes making very long songs. I mean, Jethro Tull is a good example here. They have the two albums, Thick as a Brick and Passion Play, which both are full album length songs. But all these bands, this whole movement is definitely an inspiration for progressive metal. In terms of the metal part of if we talk progressive metal, then it's basically that's where the variation really occurs. There's a very huge difference between progressive metal bands in terms of what the metal reference is for them. So, for instance, I mean, Dream Theater has a very clear link to bands like Iron Maiden, for instance. Queensryche, which I'll be talking about later, have kind of a combo of Iron Maiden and Judas Priest. Psychotic Walls are very inspired by Black Sabbath also, especially the Born Again era with Ian Gillan. They even covered a song from that album on one of the re-releases of one of their albums. And Face Warning have, which I will also be talking about later, have all of the above, but also some inspiration from Merciful Fate, Danish power metal band of the 1980s. And in recent years, a lot of prog bands have begun to have more kind of complex thrash metal bands as their metal reference, especially the whole djent genre, which is a subgenre of progressive metal, named after a particular kind of Nishuga riff that sounds like djent. So that's true, that's actually why it's called djent. But anyway, they have Nishuga as a reference, but then build progressive metal on that. So they have bands like Textures and others. And Symphony X has Pantera as a reference in their progressive metal, a very kind of groove thrash based progressive metal. But in all cases, there's kind of a metal base, and then there's some influences from that you can kind of trace back to the 1970s. But the problem with the problem with this definition attempt is that there are actually some bands who actually move forward and stop quoting the same references. I mean, there are actually some bands that do not quote explicitly 1970s references and do not or that deviate so much from them that it becomes kind of not a little bit too general or imprecise to say that they are that this is what is constitutive for their music. There are actually some bands who are considered progressive who do not quite quote 1970s prog. Another problem is that if we make the reference to progressive rock be the answer to the question, then we basically just push the question to, well, what is progressive rock then? What makes progressive rock progressive? Because that's actually also a problematic question, because those bands also varied in all sorts of ways, and they were not always eclectic, and they were not always playing with rhythm structures and stuff like that. They were also very diverse. So we're kind of just pushing the question to a different era by saying that it's all about 70s progressive rock. So this leads us to definition attempt number 3, which leads us, which we could go into saying something about the structure of the music as such. Something that, as you've heard here with the first Dream Theater example, something that actually that runs deep in progressive metal is to have a lot of changes. I've heard it I've seen it formulated as progressive music is music that progresses within in a given song from one part to another. So it's music that metal that has a lot of parts and changes in it. For instance, frequently, but not always. Epic songs. I mean, there's very often very very long songs in progressive metal. Sometimes, as I said earlier, a very typical length is 20 minutes for big opuses, and in some cases you also have multi-part songs that run up to 50 minutes plus. So that's definitely one way in which metal has a lot of parts and changes in it. It's progressive and epic. But they can also be have a lot of changes within a short space. There are a lot of pieces of progressive metal music where you have many different styles and genres and atmospheres and rhythm sections and so on crammed into relatively little space. So that's also a trait that you have these many changes in within a single song. And especially rhythm changes. I mean, there's loads of time signature changes typically in progressive metal. The Dream Theater example here is again a good one in terms of constantly changing rhythm patterns. It's like the more complex, the better. But the problem with all this is that it's not universal. There's not that you can actually find bands that are called progressive metal bands which do none of these things. And one of those is actually one of the seminal progressive metal acts, Queensryche. I'm going to play a little bit from a fairly late Queensryche album from 1994. They were actually around since the early 1980s. And they have been very inspired by Pink Floyd, so that's the tie to the 1980s. But they deal more in long kind of album stretch runs of music, or they deal very much in concert albums where you really have to hear the whole album to kind of experience the concept they have in mind, or the musical ideas they have in mind. They kind of run for entire albums, and if you single out single songs, they are not really necessarily that complex. They're often fairly straightforward rock structured songs with not a lot of changes in them. But they have some other traits that we could discuss in a moment once I've played a little bit of this for you. It's difficult to choose a very representative Queensryche example because they also actually changed a lot from one album to the other. some of the early Queensryche stuff is varied with very high-pitched vocals and lots of quite heavy in a kind of traditional true metal way. But then they kind of gradually became a little bit more pop influenced and got more Pink Floyd influences into it. And they also started experimenting more with studio techniques and getting more orchestration and stuff into the music. But I'll just play a little bit of this and then discuss it afterwards. So this is the opening of the Promised Land album, and that is for those listening on Skype, that is the two next examples. The 9:28 a.m. is the intro that leads directly into IMI, the song IMI. From the album From His Land. So, yeah. Let me just see here. Here we go.
Thank you. that's how it ends. Then it segues into a different song from there. Okay, yeah. So with Kringschweig, they showcase something else about progressive metal, something which is typical but definitely not universal trait of progressive metal. They had this very dramatic and theatrical atmospheres in their songs. It's very, as you hear, it's very pompous. There's a lot of the orchestration is brought in to really make it more dynamic and riveting. This particular song has a kind of more upbeat and more uplifting atmosphere, in my opinion, with kind of typical metal self-asserting lyrics and so on. But there's a lot of Kringschweig which deals more with really like really depressing emotions or very kind of heartfelt psychological problematic issues. So they have very often very reflective kind of borderline philosophical lyrics. Probably the most ambitious album they've made lyric-wise is maybe Operation Mindcrime back from 1986. Okay. Anyway, where they have this, they have a storyline running through Operation Mindcrime about this evil doctor who controls people's minds, and there's a nun who, or a prostitute that turns, that's turned nun, and there's a lot of weird things happening, and a lot of emotion in it, in the story, where people really cry their heart out, and it's very, very dramatic and very, very theatrical. Jeff Tate, who was the lead singer. Yeah, was the lead singer of Kringschweig actually. He recently was thrown out after being a drama queen. But yeah, well, that's the truth. There was some.
They expelled him from the band.
Well, there's a little bit of digression, but there was a lot. There's been a lot of problematic private issues within the band. Because Jeff Tate at some point employed his wife as the manager, and when the rest of the band wanted to fire her, he got really upset and started flaming them on stage and stuff like that. So there was a lot of tension that arose from that. But there's been a long history of tension within the band and a former band.
So when you say flaming them on stage, you mean?
Yeah, sorry, been yelling abuse at them, basically calling them assholes and stuff.
Oh,
like
I
that.
See.
So anyway,
charming.
Yeah, but anyway, Jeff Tate, he actually came from a family that where both his parents sang opera, and there was a lot of he had a background where it was very common to have this more kind of theatrical approach to performance and so on. So that definitely something that has. Sifted into Kringschweig as a shower trade. And there's also this everything goes approach they have to the studio production of the thing, of the music. It's okay for them to just, I mean, they didn't, I remember an interview back from when this album came out where they were asked them like, what, okay, so you have like 100 tracks of different instruments in the song, how are you going to perform that live? Well, we haven't really thought about that. they really thought in terms of okay, what would make the album sound good. But they've influenced a lot of people with this, or influenced a lot of other bands with this approach to atmosphere and approach to, or this particular kind of energy they have in their music. But so anyway, Kringschweig showcases a band where this more structural aspect of progressive metal, this with many parts and changes, is not that important again. But there are some other things about them that fit some of the other traits that we've discussed in connection with progressive metal. Now, This kind of leads into a different discussion about progressive metal, namely that of looking, instead of looking at progressive metal as a coherent genre, where there are some different traits that are fixed, you could choose to look at progressive metal from the intentional aspect of the musicians, or rather the intentional relations of the musicians to the music. So that's actually what Jeff Wagner, who has written one of the very, very few books there is on progressive metal, I just recently acquired it, it's called Mean Deviation, 4 Decades of Progressive Heavy Metal, and so far it's really good actually. But by the way, I will return to this book a little later in the talk as well when we discuss some of the similarities between metal and progressive heavy metal, because he's actually one of the people who argues that maybe I should put that on as well. He actually argues that progressive metal and metal has very much developed side by side ever since Black Sabbath. If you think of the album Sabbath, Bloody Sabbath from 1973, Black Sabbath had like 3 albums before that where they had a very the style they developed, where this is very distinctive style with all unison instruments or instruments where you think of iconic tracks such as Iron Man and stuff like that, you have everyone following the same basic riff. So the drums, the bass, the guitar, even the singer has this ding 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 ding. It just everything follows the same path, so to speak, within the song, kind of making it extra heavy in the sense of heavy-handed actually, because everyone is just kind of dragged into the same bombastic rhythm. But when we approach, there's some fun stuff that's happening on Volume 4 as well, but when we approach Sabbath, Bloody Sabbath, that's all dispensed of. You start having songs that are much more complex and with lots of things happening and lots of different parts in them. There's the multi-part song, what's it called? Killing Myself to Live, or Killing Yourself to Live, sorry, which has a lot of different parts in it. And there's a lot of different kinds of music on the album as well. So Black Sabbath showcases an artist which all a general attitude within metal that within some point that there's a lot of artists who at some point grow a little tired of the genre they have established and then try to transcend that and try to start playing with the conventions. Metallica went through a similar development in the early 90s where they also went from, after having developed a certain thrash style, they started fooling around with more pop music influenced ideas and eventually did a rock album with Load and went back again to something more old school a little later. So anyway, this idea of wanting to be progressive or progress in your music is an attitude that runs in metal as such. But for Jeff Wagner, it's something that is kind of constitutive of what we call progressive metal. It's something that indicates a process for the musician rather than a set of traits as such. As a side remark, I actually got into, as I said earlier, I actually got into metal via a progressive rock band, which was a very obscure Japanese band called Providence, which should not be confused.
Not only obscure, but Japanese. I said not only obscure, but Japanese.
Yeah, also Japanese. But anyway, there's also a newer thrash band with the same name, So I actually started listening to progressive rock via that album. I also started looking into progressive metal and metal in itself. So there's definitely some deep structure structural similarities between progressive rock as such and metal as such. And I think that Jeff Wagner here is right in identifying that similarity as this idea of wanting to do something new and wanting to kind of push the boundaries of the music all the time. And Yeah, so he speaks a lot actually, this not so much about progressive music, but about progressive artists. So he considers artists progressive when they actually try to do this, try to strive to free themselves of the genre constraints that they have built for themselves, and try to do something else. And this is this I think is probably what makes a band like Queensrÿche progressive, because if you compare Queensrÿche to a lot of other bands that have the moniker progressive on them, they are very different. I mean, they have the songs are pretty straight actually. But what really makes them progressive could be said to be the fact that they actually try to progress from album to album. There's not a lot of Queensrÿche albums, okay, maybe some of the newer ones, but there are a lot of the first like five or six ones. There are not that many they're not really alike. I mean, after Promised Land, they went on to do Here in the Now Frontier, which is actually a fairly straightforward rock album, which pissed a lot of fans off. But which, in hindsight, is actually a cool album. It's just not what you'd expect from them at that point. But exactly because it's not what you'd expect from them, it's actually a very progressive move. They were very progressive to do that. Yeah, I think this is something that if we think back to, okay, can we use this to define the genre? Then I would say that not all bands within the prog genre spectrum strive to rise above themselves, but there are many who do that. But here's my first parallel to philosophy. In the same way that you have philosophers tend to strive for a higher level of abstraction all the time, going from the concrete phenomena to more general ideas, or from a single discipline like ethics to a more abstract discipline like meta-ethics, and so on. Progressive artists, they seem to constantly strive for a kind of consciousness of their own genre, to kind of go from, okay, now we did this, now we want to play with it and do something else. That seems to be a general attitude. If you listen to, and especially if you listen to Dream Theater again, on the first couple of albums, they've used a lot of time to define their genre, but then from Scenes from a Memory from 1999 and onwards, they take the genre and then use it as an element in the music, basically. So they start having something that where they kind of can refer back to, okay, now we're doing something classic Dream Theater. This is something that fans will immediately recognize as referring back to images and words, and now we're doing something that sounds like Tool, now we're going back to this. So they kind of take these different elements and especially the genre that they've established themselves and start to play around with it as a building block, so to speak. So this is a general, very general attitude that a lot of progressive metal artists strive to kind of rise above in the same way that the philosophers strive to rise above themselves in on the conceptual level. So that was one parallel. Yes. And now for the self-explanatory chapter. There's also, of course, an element of canonization within progressive metal, in the sense that there are some people, or opinion makers within progressive metal milieu, who define what we consider to be progressive metal. There are some people who set the agenda for what we allow as progressive metal, and probably one of at least for a long time and up until around 2000 something, Dream Theater has been one of those kind of game makers or game people who defined the game, and so when Dream Theater started to allow inspirations from the band Tool, for instance, into their music, people started to talk about Tool as a progressive metal band. Up until then, people considered Tool a grunge band, which sometimes did some weird stuff with rhythms and so on. But when Dream Theater started actually doing stuff that was very similar to Tool, they have an almost, it's kind of borderline theft on the song Home from Scenes from a Memory, where they have a riff that's almost lifted out of a Tool song called 46 and 2 from the Enema album. And when they did that, when they started actually incorporating elements of Tool's music or inspirations from Tool into the music, people, the prog fans, started to look to Tool and say, yeah, that's actually a quite cool band, and let's try to listen to that a little bit more. So Dream Theater has been in that way definers of what counted as prog. Even though Radiohead has never been a progressive metal band, they have actually gone on to be looked at by prog fans as a progressive rock band, also because of Dream Theater, because they also started to draw in inspiration from Radiohead and some of the things they did. So they have really been very defining of what progressive metal is. And if we expand this a bit to talk about the issue of canonization in general, this also is very curious exactly when something gets gained and or allowed access to being called progressive metal. And a case in point, just a counter example here, is a counterexample is the band Mr. Bungle, which is sadly disbanded. But this is the band, for those who don't know, whose vocalist Mike Patton went on to join Faith No More, and Mr. Bungle existed parallel to Faith No More for a long period. And it was kind of an outlet for not only for Mike Patton but also for other musicians for more bizarre material, to say the least. But Mr. Bungle is actually fits a lot of the things, a lot of the different traits that we've discussed earlier in connection with progressive metal. They are progressive. They in terms of actually doing something new, from one album to the other. They have some very clear inspiration from the 70s. There's a lot of Frank Zappa influence in their albums, in terms of the way that they use weird sounds and genre codes and so on. And they also have like songs with lots of changes in them. They have clearly had a very progressive attitude towards the music, because they go from one genre to a completely different genre, and then kind of have a everything goes if it supports the song approach. But they are not actually considered prog. I'll just play a little bit of a song here. And for those on Skype, it's The Air Conditioned Nightmare in the playlist. It's number 4. So I don't know if I'll play the whole thing, but we'll see how much we make it through here.
Bye.
improvised fate here, even though it's a great song, I'd like to hear the whole thing, but we also need to move forward. But it's very curious that Mr. Bungle is actually not called prog. They're called they're sometimes called avant-garde metal, there are actually also that there this is probably the most curious thing about them, that there are actually progressive metal bands that have been inspired by them, like Pain of Salvation and also later Between the Buried and Me and so on. There's a lot of these people who are very clearly influenced by Mr. Bungle, also explicitly. But still, they are not really considered progressive metal. Another contemporary band, Dog Fashion Disco, was also very much inspired by Mr. Bungle. It's called circus metal as a genre. So it's quite kind of curious. yeah. But. If we look to, I mean, this is not, now we're talking about progressive metal as what the kind of the majority says is progressive metal, because if you look to the site Prog Archives, which is probably the most comprehensive online resource on anything prog related, both progressive rock and progressive metal, they are extremely liberal on the matter of which bands to include. They have everything that's just remotely connected to the progressive genre. They even have Stevie Dan listed as a progressive, as a reference band, which probably has to do with the fact that there are progressive rock bands that have referenced Stevie Dan. So they kind of have been accepted into the pantheon of things that are kind of prog. So it's very. If you expand the view a little, it becomes, or if you take the approach of prog archives, it becomes even more difficult to define what prog is. But what I'm discussing in this talk is very much kind of the more should we say the more general or more common understanding of what progressive metal is. And yeah, as I said earlier, it has been the rule that if Dream Theater references something, then it becomes acceptable to do that within progressive metal. And a very key album here is Scenes from a Memory from 1999, where subsequent albums where they really really started to bring in a lot of other kinds of references. In the first two albums, it was more like Rush and Iron Maiden and some other 70s influences. But after, from around Scenes from a Memory, they started bringing in a lot of more contemporary references in the music. Good. Family resemblances. Now, one family resemblance that you could, of course, draw with a lot of bands is to Dream Theater. But there are other bands as well that have been influential within progressive metal or in defining what progressive metal is, which I'll get to in a short moment. But first I'd like to say something about musical genres as such. I've argued in the chapter I wrote for Black Sabbath and Philosophy, Master and Reality, called Black Sabbath and the Problem of Defining Metal. I've argued in this chapter that what makes a necessary condition for being a metal band is that you have some kind of trait that you can trace back to Black Sabbath, or rather, it's descriptive, it's not something you should, but if you look to metal bands, you can kind of always find something that, at least, if not directly, then through some kind of intermediary band, can be traced back as a genre trait to something that Black Sabbath has done, because they've had a foot in all kinds of areas of prototypes for metal, both progressive metal with Black Sabbath, but also Doom on the first couple of Black Sabbath albums, modern thrash metal with some parts of the Paranoid album, even grunge, actually, if you look to an album like Sabotage, there's a very clear line from Sabotage to a band like Alice in Chains, for instance. So there's a lot of very clear lines to the contemporary metal genres that go back to Black Sabbath. I should say that I'm talking about this as a necessary condition, not a sufficient condition. So it's not a sufficient condition for being metal that you have a line that can trace a bloodline back to Black Sabbath, because there are also other bands like Queens of the Stone Age and other stoner rock bands today that also have a very clear bloodline back to Black Sabbath's early albums, but who are not considered metal. But similarly, we could say in connection with progressive metal that there has to be, that it could be a necessary condition for progressive metal that there is some sort of family relation from the bands back to the big three, as they are called in progressive metal. And just a bit of explanation here. Just as thrash metal has its big four, Metallica, Megadeth, Slayer, and Anthrax, progressive metal is generally accepted to have the big three, which is Queensrÿche, Fate's Warning, and Dream Theater. And sometimes, there's probably a lot of argument over which band would be the big fourth. Personally, when I first read this, I thought, well, the big fourth would obviously be Psychotic Waltz, which I think is kind of the fourth seminal album, fourth seminal artist from this early period of prog. But then I came to realize that, okay, Psychotic Waltz is actually predated by Fate's Warning, and Fate's Warning also has some of these really weird stuff happening that Psychotic Waltz has happening. So maybe they're not that influential as Fate's Warning. And then there's also a lot of other weird bands from the same period which have also been influenced, like Voivod and Watchtower and Nikon Delta and even the progressive death metal band Cynic, which released its first album in 1992, there's a lot of these fairly small output bands that have a cult following among contemporary artists. So it's a little bit it becomes blurry once you try to figure out, okay, who would the fourth influence be here? But these three, Queensrÿche, Fate's Warning, and Dream Theater, are kind of cornerstone references for modern progressive metal in different ways, each of them. So we've already heard Queensrÿche, who was formed in 1982, released the first EP in 1983, and we have these very theatrical and Pink Floyd-inspired albums. They had a very huge emphasis on concept albums. And they are an inspiration for some of the more expressive bands within the prog genre spectrum. I've just mentioned a few of them here. People who have a more kind of dramatic, expressive atmosphere in the music. Conception, Pain of Salvation, Leprous, a prog power metal band like Camelot, who at a time shared vocalists with Conception, a prog power thrash metal band Nevermore, and many others. There are quite a lot of bands who have this same kind of theatrical, emotional approach to progressive metal. And then there's Fate's Warning, who is also a very old band. They were also formed in 1982. They released the first album in 1984. And they are special because they are a little bit more introvert and melancholic, especially after they changed vocalists in 1987 from John Arch to Ray Alder. They became even more kind of mellow-ish in the vocal approach and in the atmospheres, and they also have some very innovative and strange chords in their music sometimes, and also have a lot of like Dream Theater. They also have a lot of experimentation with song structures, but in the same way as as Dream Theater, they are very inspired by early Rush. Up until Moving Pictures around 1981 or so. After that, Rush started to change styles towards something a little bit more synth influenced. And they're also very inspired by Merciful Fate. But in contrast to Dream Theater, who's also a very Rush inspired band, Fate's Warning is very much inspired by the more melancholic side of these. Rush and other 70s bands. They have this very special kind of fragile, sad, thoughtful atmosphere in their music. And I'll play an example just in a moment. Alongside Psychotic Waltz, which I already mentioned that I think they've influenced, They've also influenced a lot of the more experimental acts, later times, like Spiral Architect from Norway and the Spiral Architect spin-off band Twisted Into Form, which I love. Zero Hour, American tech metal band, is also inspired by Fate's Warning. Manitou from Norway, there's also a Finnish band called Manitou, that's why I indicated it here. And probably also a relatively modern progressive metal band like the Safety Fire, who I think is inspired by Fate's Warning via some intermediary steps. They're probably more inspired by Gojira and some other bands that are then inspired by Fate's Warning. But anyway, they've been very influential, but for different kinds of bands. So, Fate's Warning, I've had a very hard time deciding what to play here, because there are kind of two sides to Fate's Warning. There's one that which is the very kind of harsh, complex chords, and a bit more metal side. And then there's another very big part of Fate's Warning's output, which is more mellow and more, almost borderline ballad-like, but not in a pop music sort of way. So I ended up deciding to choose a song that is kind of half of each, basically. It's called A Fate's Hand, and this one I'm actually going to play the full 7 minutes of, just so you get an idea of the whole, of the spectrum of emotion, and also just the format of songs that Fate's Warning operate within. And yeah, this is from the album from 1989, The Perfect Symmetry, which is the first album with the drummer Mark Sonder, who stayed on for many years after that. But now they have a different drummer, but anyway. At Fate's Hand, and that's also the YouTube playlist.
Thank you.
Yep. So this ending, by the way, is extremely inspired by a classic Rush instrumental called YYC, which incidentally is the same. This is actually Rush's long-running cover artist, Hugh Simon, who's also did this cover for Phase One. But anyway, so Phase One is another one, or the third big three that I hadn't played anything by. Another big three, of course, if we take this chronologically, is of course Dream Theater, who we started off with hearing, were formed in 1985 as Majesty, and then later changed the name, the first album in 1989. And they have a lot of Rush influences, as I said before. They have a lot of time signature changes in their music, which is something they have from Rush. But they're also inspired by King Crimson and Dixie Dregs and Kansas and Genesis and a lot more 70s bands. And as I said earlier, Iron Maiden on the metal side. Some of their albums, especially Awake from 1994 and Scenes from Memory from 1999, are also kind of in the more atmospheric and dramatic category. But in general, they have an emphasis that is more on musicianship and basically on showing off. This is especially something that you can see if you see concert videos with Dream Theater or concerts. They are extremely virtuoso and very keen on doing solos and weird stuff. For a lot of people, Dream Theater is kind of what Dream Theater, what progressive metal is identified with. They simply identify progressive metal with progressive power metal, because the specific kind of subgenre that Dream Theater has spawned with the first couple of albums is progressive power metal. That's kind of the more specific term that people use for something that sounds close to the first two Dream Theater albums. That's a little bit rough because there has of course been some development within the genre. Bands like Symphony X and Pagan's Mind and Threshold, for instance, are all progressive power metal bands, but they've also brought in some extra influences and some extra things to the table, so to speak. Pagan's Mind have some very innovative chord shifts in their music, very interesting harmonic shifts or patterns. Other contemporary progressive power metal bands include Anubis Gate, for instance, and also, Enchant, who later on turned to more progressive rock as such, the Dutch band Elegy and countless others. There's a lot of progressive power metal bands out there. But this again is kind of a parallel to philosophy, because if you think of it in terms of what people look at as very often be something that has been done before and something that you are used to seeing being done. I mean, although philosophy could be about a lot of different things, we usually regard certain kinds of problems as philosophical problems because it's something that kind of has been around as a topic for philosophers since the beginning of philosophy. And it's the same thing about progressive metal. Even though progressive should indicate that you could do anything you like, it's very much the early progressive metal bands that kind of have defined what belongs to progressive metal. This becomes, and I realize that I have to speed up a little bit, so examples will get shorter. This gets even more obvious when we look to today, when people start actually experimenting with rising above what is known as progressive metal. There's a label called K-Scope, who have issued albums with Stephen Wilson, who's the former lead man of Porcupine Tree, Amplifier, Anathema, The Pineapple Thief, Lunatic Soul, which is a project from the Riverside vocalist Mariusz Duda, and many others. But they have the slogan for the label, which is post-progressive sounds. I haven't heard it that many other places, but it actually makes a lot of sense, this term, because in the same sense that you have post-rock and post-metal, which are both genres where that are, is defined by the artist not really being rock and not really being metal, but using the vocabulary of the genre as kind of an expressive means, but also but kind of doing it in a self-conscious way where they're kind of conscious of not being metal bands, for instance, but they're using something that's heavy as in a passage of the music. In the same way, you could say that post-progressive artists use vocabulary from progressive rock and metal, but they do it in a way so that they are not—they don't really consider themselves as progressive, but they are just referencing this as a genre. And the reason why this is interesting is that it kind of showcases what metal culture and music culture has come to understand as progressive metal and progressive rock. Because now you can actually listen to post-progressive artists and hear what they reference and see, all right, so that was what what progressive metal was, so to speak. I mean, that's a little bit, of course, an oversimplification, but it says a lot about what prog has become, what the archetypes of prog has become. You can actually kind of hear that when you listen to post-progressive artists. And a short example from an album that admittedly was not labeled post-progressive when it came out, but I think it's very there's a very clear line from this album to everything that's issued by Case Group, basically. It's not a Case Group issue, but Porcupine Tree's album In Absentia from 2002. I probably won't play the whole song here, but just a little bit of it, a song called Blackest Eyes. I think you will pretty get the idea pretty fast. I'll just play it. We'll be right back. into an instrumental section where fun stuff happens and when it becomes a little bit more rhythmically advanced and so on. But basically, what this shows, I think, is an example of how post-progressive artists kind of show what has become archetypes of progressive rock and metal. In this case, I mean, we have these passages with lots of rhythmical changes. If you try to count your way through this do-do-do-do and so on, it's actually quite complicated, and there's also some technically challenging things in it. Now I skipped the instrumental section because I'm running out of time, but also there's also some eclectic song structures. Some of the later Porcupine Tree material, for instance, the album Fear of a Blank Planet had an 18-minute opus on it that was called Anesthetize, which is kind of the same style of music where you have this very kind of poppy vocals and general kind of simple song structures, but then with these very heavy proggy elements with lots of time signature changes and stuff like that. And also there's this, as I was wrote here, there's also this kind of degree of pompousness in the music. It's very kind of kicks in the door. It's not exactly subtle, but so this so these are kind of things that I think post-progressive artists like Porcupine Tree, like Stephen Wilson Solo and Amplifier and other people have shown that this is what people have come to understand by prog. This is this kind of edgy, very rhythmically busy music style with lots of changes in it, and which all often has this very epic atmosphere.
I'm not quite following you. This song you just played. Mm-hmm. I think it would better be placed after the 1970 music. It's like they have taken this 1970 music and got it inspired by heavy metal. Not, it seems they have cut the progressive metal out as an unnecessary step.
Well, I see what you mean, but yeah, I'm probably also influenced by the fact that I know a bit about the genesis of this album. In absentia, and the producer Stephen Wilson worked with Opeth prior to this album, so he got in a lot of metal influences in his music. So even though he's Porcupine Tree existed before that and has had a lot of 70s influences in the music and also conscious 70s influence, but this kind of more heavy version of progressive that you hear, this kind of riff they have here. It definitely comes via progressive metal, but you're right. I mean, from the listener's point of view, it's as if they do rock music that's directly inspired by the 70s. I get your point. So the next point I had here, and I have to just skip gently through this because we're running out of time, is that there are other. Apart from the. The progressive or the kind of post-progressive genre, the way we can also see similar emphasis on different aspects of the prog metal genre. If we look to black metal and death metal acts that start incorporating progressive metal in their music, there again we see via what is added to the music, what these bands consider to be archetypes of progressive metal. And the example that I wanted to play here, but simply don't have time for, unfortunately, is Enslaved. The opening of the album Vertebrae, the song called Clouds. Maybe I can just play the opening of it again, just to get a little short idea. We'll be right back. this is the opening here. There's also some rhythmically complex things coming later in the piece as well. They have some very fantastic changes, but you can look at the playlist when you get home, or hear the whole thing in the playlist when you get home. But they have these bits and pieces which are really difficult time signature wise. This opening is a da 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 da, where they have these really kind of weird syncopations. Later on in the piece, they have this passage which sounds a bit like something from a 70s rock band, where they have some very unexpected changes between in terms of time signature. So again, you have this emphasis on the challenging rhythmic patterns. That's again kind of what's become understood as a progressive metal trait. Enslaved also showcased something which is very common in the death metal or progressive death metal and progressive black metal. They are sometimes referred to as progressive Viking black metal, because they sing about Vikings and Norse mythology and so on, and black metal for obvious reasons. But they also showcase this kind of 1970s prog influenced production. So they have this kind of Hammond organ and Moog and stuff incorporated, and that's something which has become very much part of the genre, with the artists like Amorphis and also Opeth and other examples. So that's also a way in which these bands directly quote the prog genre as such, not just progressive metal but also progressive rock.
Yes.
So. Yeah, it should of course be mentioned that and this is something that Jeff Barkin also describes, that there's kind of a shared history of between metal and progressive metal all the way through, and that's also the case with progressive death metal. There's a lot of the early death metal bands who very quickly started doing progressive stuff. Cynic is the case in point, but also Emperor, where there's kind of a fluid transition from Emperor's material and into Isar's soul material in terms of becoming more and more progressive and more and more complex. And this is again one of the points that Jeff Barkin makes. Yeah, the next thing here, I'm just going to skip quickly through this because I had some examples of the puzzling thing with the, okay, when do we add, or when what happens when people start incorporating different types of progressive metal into their music, or different types of genre traits, because at some point there's so much of these that the music kind of stops being the main genre, and this is the case with Opeth, for instance, who has gone from being called a progressive death metal band to simply becoming a progressive metal band. And it's interesting because there are other bands like, there are other progressive metal bands like Leprous, for instance, from Norway, who has been progressive metal, playing pure and simple from the beginning, but who also have incorporated growls in their music as an expressive element. But for Opeth, it's first when they disposed of the growls that people started referring to them as just progressive metal. And then I'm running out of time, sorry. I also wanted to say a few things about Devin Townsend, because I think Devin Townsend is an interesting example of an artist who is progressive, but who doesn't necessarily make progressive metal, because a lot of his output is just metal, pure and simple. It's very heavy and very kind of pompous, and has influenced a lot of artists from especially the Swedish melodeath scene and so on, also via his old band Strapping on Lad. But the way that he works with music is extremely progressive. At one point he can do, and I really just have to pay like 20 seconds just to show you the contrast between these two things, okay? So
you can do a whole seminar on Devin Townsend.
Yeah, I can do a whole seminar on Devin Townsend, but I just want to showcase the contrast, okay? So he can do stuff like this. And he could do stuff like this.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, he can go from doing albums that are all out pompous extreme metal to doing things like one of his latest albums, Casualties of Cool, which is a country music meets ambient album, and very very special and not the least bit metal, but totally great. But anyway, he showcases the kind of progressive attitude to music, which is probably why he's often mentioned in concerts with progressive metal and often plays at progressive metal festivals and so on and so forth. So that was basically what I said here. Yeah, and the final afterthought I would say here is that actually what makes progressive rock and metal progressive, or what could be said to make progressive rock and metal progressive, is perhaps the listener. Because we were talking about earlier about canonization and how it's sometimes a little bit curious how things become accepted as progressive. I think that if I look to progressive metal stations, it's very much what the people who listen to progressive rock and metal start playing and recommend to other people, which is gradually accepted as being progressive. So it's what the listeners within the community accepts into the genre that becomes part of it. In short, we could say that progressive metal is a genre is only as progressive as the listeners allow it to be. And I say this also kind of hinting at the problems that there often are with bands in ranging from Green Theater to Opeth and others who do something radically different. There will always be some people who, even though the band is extremely progressive to begin with, who are offended by the genre change and who don't accept it. So it's very much up to what the listeners accept, what is allowed into progressive metal. And had I had time, this would have been my closing example. Nisan, who's the front man of Emperor, has gradually moved into doing full-fledged progressive metal and fantastic progressive metal. But he is, I don't know if you can see the image here, what it is.
It's Nietzsche, isn't it?
Yes. So he is very explicitly inspired by philosophy in his lyrics and also in his general attitude towards making music. He even has his latest album, Das Seelenbrechen, is inspired by a quote from Nietzsche about what art is. That is like, yeah, Das Seelenbrechen, the breaking of the soul, and stuff like that. But anyway, that was what I managed to say within these 2 hours.
Very much, sir. And you have all these clips on the playlist, right?
Yeah,
this is not a problem. Everybody can listen to it. Could I ask you to unmute the speaker there so that our Skype audience can?
Yes, absolutely. This is this one.
Yes. Yeah. Great. Okay. Everyone out in the Skype land, you're welcome to join in the discussion as well. We'll probably keep the discussion a bit short because we are somewhat over time now. So, does anybody have some? Really quick comments which he or she would like to make right now? Johnny. Yeah.
I have actually also read Jeff Wagner's book, and I find it quite cool. Later on in the book, he makes a distinguishes between progressive metal with a capital P and progressive metal with a small p.
Okay.
And a progressive metal with a capital P, that's metal in the tradition of the big three.
Okay.
And then with a small p, it's true, as I would call it, true progressive metal, like Enslaved, for instance, who evolved all the time.
Okay, yeah. Fair enough. That makes sense.
So yes,
I haven't reached that point yet.
No, it's in the end, I think.
So, okay, yeah.
Towards the end, yeah.
I skimmed through the parts that I hadn't read before writing my book because I didn't have time to read through it, but it's this really well written, but that makes sense, I think, yeah.
Okay. Is anybody burning to make a comment in here? Because otherwise, what we'll do is we'll see, does anybody out in Skype land have something to say?
Yes.
Yes, Lars, please.
Thanks for the talk. It was very interesting. As I said, I'm doing a PhD thesis that taps very much into the same kind of issues. I also do some analysis with Queensryche and Fitzwarren. And what I think is, what is my concern is to try to wrestle the whole idea of progress from this progressive rock thing. So, for when it comes to music, this sensibility is often reduced to what I call some progressive markers, and you talked a lot about them, which are derived from some particular understanding about progressive rock, like complexity and sophistication. But prioritizing those markers may make sense when talking about some bands like Dream Theater, but not so much other that nevertheless yields the description progressive. And you talked about it much when you went to Queensryche. But I think also there's a link when into more mainstream metal, like Iron Maiden and Metallica, and all these bands also having albums that are called progressive. What I think is interesting is to look at the metal part of this progressive labeling and see it as to look at articulation of progress beyond such progressive markers and seeing it as a sensibility that is manifested dialogically. And if you see it more like a dialogical property, it will what is progress? It will always be shifting and context dependent, and also linked to subject positioning. And that was, I think, what you were touching at the very end there. But I think it's very important to see how the music, who it's authenticized, and you didn't talk much about gender or race or class or these kind of issues. Do you have any comments?
Well, I think obviously there are because progressive metal is metal, there are of course some general discussions in terms of cultural discussions that are also relevant for progressive metal in terms of being metal, such as the fact that it's a very male dominated genre still. There are female artists of course, but it's not that many, and also some of the the general cultural aspects of metal, such as the whole emphasis on bands, for instance, that you have this very it's almost like it's a small tribe playing music rather than an emphasis on the cover artists that you have in the pop music industry, for instance. And all of those aspects of metal are also prominent in progressive metal, but I think that especially today, when progressive metal has now it's been around for more than a decade, and therefore it's more than that, but it's reached a point where the musicians I think are becoming conscious of not having to be metal as such. There are so many artists within the prog spectrum who use metal as an element, but who don't feel constrained by it, who readily go out and make albums that have no metal on them at all. Again, Opeth is a case in point. It's kind of an open, a debatable question whether the latest album they made is metal or not. There are some very kind of rock, heavy rock elements in it, but it is at least heavy in a very different way than the earliest material they made. And also, I mean, they haven't shied away from doing an album like Damnation, for instance, which is completely metal all the way through. So I think that there's a general attitude among many progressive artists, which is actually going away from just being understanding themselves as metal. I mean, a lot of artists kind of cringe a little bit about being lumped into the same category as some of these more kind of powerful leather-clad personalities in metal, and I actually more thinking of what they're doing as music, pure and simple, and not really metal. So I don't know if that answers your question. So for the metal part, then yes, of course, there's a lot of cultural aspects which are relevant to metal in general, which is also relevant here. But in terms of the progressive part, I think that musicians are more today within the genre are much more focused on the technical aspect of the music and on the more kind of the intertextuality of the music and how it refers to other things.
Can I continue?
Sure.
Yeah, because I think what you're talking about, the technicality, mm-hmm. it never, you know, departs from these cultural aspects of authentication. So, the whole issue about elitism, mm-hmm. that's interesting way into it, and other forms of masculinity, mm-hmm. for instance, than the, you know, the hyper-masculinity. Mm-hmm. You can have, you know, a kind of thinking man's mm-hmm. kind of masculinity that is as, you know, hyper-masculine in his own way.
Yeah, I think I understand what you're heading at here. If you look to the early progressive metal bands, and especially if you see videos back from the late 80s and so on, it's definitely true that there is kind of an emphasis on masculinity and have this hard rocker attitude. Also if you see bands on stage from that period, it is very masculine, very self-asserting in a masculine way, but I also strangely think I see a move from that away from that in many bands today. If you think of I don't know if you're familiar with bands such as Pain and Salvation and Leprous, but these bands kind of deal with more should we say more fragile emotions in the music that they make. It's very sometimes very heavy, and it's definitely prog. But they kind of wear their emotions on the sleeves in a way which is not something that you would normally associate it with this kind of masculine metal culture. It's kind of okay to be a little bit soft and metrosexual, so to speak, in your stage appearance than it was before. But that's with a small group of bands. I think you're right that it's probably still the case with a lot of the bulk of metal bands, including progressive metal bands. I mean, there's a lot of masculinity in bands like Symphony X and Pagan's Mind and a lot of these acts that are really just about power on stage. But I think there may be a move away from that eventually. I think there are historical reasons for the male dominance in progressive metal. I don't think that it's kind of a constitutive part of the genre as such.
Yeah, okay. I didn't mean it was like the stereotypical masculinity, but it's, you know, talk about masculinities mm-hmm. in a plural, and, you know, it makes a space for mm-hmm. another kind of masculinity in heavy metal, mm-hmm. I think.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for that long and very interesting comment. I hope that, by the way, before we move on, Lars, did you have anything else you wanted to add?
No.
No, okay. Mika, did you have anything you wanted to add briefly? Mika?
Yes, can you read me?
Yeah.
Right. First of all, Søren, thanks for your very comprehensive presentation. I mean, I have something listening to do when this is over. I'm going to slide back to the progressive metal side, to the dark side, as you know. But actually, what I think about the progressive, wing, from my point of view, I think that I went to see Opeth last November, and 6-7 years ago I saw Dream Theater in Helsinki, and what is very typical in these sessions is that every other person in the audience is musician.
Yeah.
Like in Tampere, in Opeth concert, there were like 85% of them, I know from appearance that they are actually musicians. And this comes, I think that it's very challenging to make a distinction what is actually progressive metal. But if you come to the if you take this kind of like you said this kind of canon or kind of traditions type of approach, you can always ask, do you have, what is your relationship with the Opeth? Mm. It's all right. Yes, I listen. Or do you have a relationship with the Prim Theater? Or maybe you do have some relationship with Russ and everything that like that. And if you kind of have this kind of link to the past, you probably can make that kind of investigations when you actually go through those links. And but I agree what you said about this masculinity or being non-masculine, more like feminine, because, and I think that the progressive style is a little bit kind of nerdy. No offense. It's like jazz music musicians among the metal musicians. You know what I mean?
Yeah, sure. I mean, this. Yeah. I mean, there's definitely. I mean, some of the a band like Cynic, for instance, who started out being labeled as progressive death metal, then has gone on to being called jazz metal, actually, also at a point. Even though it's not, I mean, they have some sounds in their music which is reminiscent of jazz, but structurally it's not jazz at all. It's very, very highly composed and very detailed music. Very orderly in every aspect. But jazz metal is definitely a concept that's thrown around as well as a subgenre of progressive metal. So there are definitely links, and I totally agree that it's the most geeky genre in the world, and there are lots of musicians who, or especially guitarists, who really, really dig progressive metal, because there's so much to look at on stage in terms of fast solos and that sort of things. But yeah.
Thank you, Mika. Thank you, and it's good to see you again, Mika. It's been far too long since we've had a chance to meet, so I'm so glad you're here today. Daniel, do you have anything you'd like to add as we conclude?
Well, it really wouldn't be kind of short, because it would be hitting on one of my old favorite topics of genre definitions and all that, but it might actually take a bit long to kind of get into. So I actually think we're going to leave that for another time.